We are back with more virtual interviews here at StarWest. I'm very excited that we have Pamela with us. Pamela, thanks for joining us.
Thank you. I'm happy to be here.
One of the things I think is interesting for those of you watching out there, some of you may say, hey, you know, how do I get to the conference? How do I get an opportunity to speak or participate in it? So I think, Pamela, it'd be great for you to kind of tell your story on how you ended up speaking here, you know, and how that process worked for you and why you kind of decided to do that, just to give them some context.
Okay, well, I just started speaking this year, and it wasn't something, speaking at conferences wasn't a goal of mine, but I had a story that I was really excited about, and I had written about it, and that was great, but I was still just talking about it, and several people suggested, you know, you should do a presentation on that,
yeah.
And I just... I got an email about StarWest
call for proposals.
Right, and I just went for it.
Yeah, and so I think people should know that are watching. I mean, it really is that simple, right? They typically, if you've been to the conference before or if you're on their list now, they'll send emails and just say, we're looking for speaker proposal submissions. Submit your proposal. And, you know, it's not that complex. You basically have a title. You have a brief description you want just to get them, you know, kind of an idea of what you're going to talk about.
Mm-hmm.
It gets submitted. Those get reviewed. And then you usually get a call where Lee or someone will call you
yes,
and
it was
say,
Lee.
Usually Lee, and just talk to you about what you're going to talk about and, you know, kind of goes through it. And then they make some decisions and call you and say, congratulations, we're going to put your talk in. And you get an email. And then what's nice about that, for those that don't know, is you actually then get your conference admission.
Yes, that is very nice.
So it gets you the admission. So if you're struggling out there with how do I get someone to pay to send me to the conference, mm-hmm. at least if you submit and you're a speaker, you'll at least get the conference admission portion covered. So you don't have to worry about that. Obviously, you may have to have travel, but at least that portion's covered.
Right.
So maybe let's talk a little bit about what your topic was on yesterday. So you what your talk was about so that they know what the talk was.
It was called Improved Testing with a Zone Defense. And I did kind of a sports theme.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, I started off with a sports theme. My theme's kind of went all over the place.
Yeah.
But it's about using defects that are reported by customers, finding recurring themes among those defects, and then... devising strategies to cover those themes.
That's great.
Those zones.
Those zones.
Yes.
Yeah,
as,
literally.
As groups.
Right. Yeah, that's awesome. I mean, because when you think about it, right, it's just like I think about it in terms of children, right? When there's more of them than you, you have to do zone defense and figure
that's
out
right.
how to handle it,
that's
right?
That's right, when they outnumber you.
Yeah, when they outnumber you, and more than likely in software, there's going to be more bugs than there are time to test or testers to look after them. So, you know, how do you break that into chunks where you can manage it, do some analysis on it, figure out how to get the broadest coverage you can.
Right.
You know, and tackle those. So how did that go? Were you sensing that kind of resonated with the folks in the session? Were they kind of understanding what you were trying to do? And
I think so. Because, you know, it's, for one thing, it's about examining these bugs and finding the traits in the bugs and what to do about them. But there's also another bit of a message, too, which
yeah.
is that you really need to be looking at the hard data. You need mm-hmm. to be looking at your bugs to know the quality of your product.
Yep.
Because, you know, it happens sometimes that you get a release out and, you know, say there's a big customer who loves the new features and they, you know, send your CTO an email and everybody talks about how great a release it is.
Right.
But, you know, that doesn't tell you about the experience of the hundreds or thousands
right.
of testers using your product.
Mm-hmm.
And it goes the other way, too, that someone, you know, someone doesn't see the feature they want or they run into some bugs or something and suddenly
mm-hmm.
it's a horrible release.
Yeah.
But that doesn't describe the
no.
experience of the users either.
Right. Exactly. And what type of, just to give some context for people out there, what type are you guys doing mobile testing? Are you doing web testing? What are you kind of focused on? for where you've seen it work and where you've used it. I'm sure it can work for anything, but where have you kind of been using that strategy in terms of your own day-to-day life and world?
Oh, sure. So I work at TestPlant, where we make the eggplant testing tools. And I'm testing the testing tools. You know, what I'm talking about in the presentation is our eggplant functional product. But, I mean, it's really... It really applies to performance testing and mobile testing and, I mean, every place where there are users and bugs.
You can really apply that principle. And I think it's so interesting because, I mean, really your consumer is all those people out there probably watching that are using your tools. So being a tester whose customer is testers, you have a lot of very knowledgeable people on how to find issues and defects and things that they...
You have no idea.
You have a very savvy customer base.
Yes, we do.
So unlike just traditional customers out there in the wild, right, you have definitely a very educated customer base on how they want things to work and they think it should work and when they find things.
Yes, they are educated and they are vocal, as they should be.
Right.
I mean, we definitely want to make them happy.
Yeah, absolutely. Now, as a, so you've seen the conference also, you know, just from what you guys do, obviously you guys come to the conference, you know, with the tool and stuff as well. Have you gotten to, this year, have you gotten to sit in on a lot of the sessions or participate in some of them as well?
I actually went to more sessions this year than I have in the past, and I love the sessions.
Yeah.
But at the same time, you know, I miss the booth. The first time I came here, I spent a lot of time in the booth, and I was really nervous about that because I'm not in a customer-facing job. You know, but I'm just getting to talk to other testers about our product.
And hear directly from them.
Yeah, it's really fun. And I mean, as much as I love the sessions and actually presenting this time, I'm trying not to focus on our products in my presentation. I want to be talking tester to tester, not vendor to tester.
Right, exactly. And having the more that, here's my experience as a tester and a peer.
Right.
As opposed to a vendor.
Right. But in the booth, I get to show off our stuff and fly my eggplant flag.
So which is fun, too. So you kind of get both perspectives. So again, what people don't see is there's a whole vendor area and vendor fair that you can go to that has all the different tools and companies that are supporting testing and all the testers out there that they can go see, which is fun too, right? To get exposure to some of the new tools and the new functionality that's coming out, the stuff that you guys are working on, the stuff that a lot of other organizations are working on to help make the job of everyone out there a little bit easier.
Right.
You know, hopefully, and give them the tools they need to be successful. So for people who maybe haven't heard of the tools that you guys have, can you just kind of give us a brief overview of, you know, kind of what they do and where they could leverage and utilize some of the tools you guys have?
Oh, I'd love to. So we have our eggplant functional testing tool, which is, it used to just be called eggplant when it was the only product. It's now eggplant functional.
Which is so cute. I love that name.
Oh,
it just creates such a fun image.
But... That is an image-based testing tool, and we can use it to test pretty much anything. We connect to the system under test through VNC or Windows RDP, and then we use mouse, keyboard, touch actions to control the system under test. And, you know, that's really cool and fun and simple, and like my kids love to play with it.
Oh, I bet.
But at the same time, you know, you can do all the things you can do with, with, you know, traditional scripting languages too. All the heavy duty
languages,
scripting.
So just a preference, right? Of how do you want to do that, right? Do you want to use a scripting language, or do you want to use more of a tool like that to be able to do it?
That's right, and it's going to be. I mean, the best is a combination of those things.
And using both for where it fits you and where your skill set is, right?
Right.
So different people have different strengths and skill sets to be able to use different things.
We've got a huge range of users.
Oh, I bet. And it's just kind of interesting to see when you're building a tool, right, you know, trying to serve people who are incredibly advanced as well as some people who maybe need more help and, you know, making it user-friendly for all ranges of knowledge in that product would be fun to kind of think about.
It is fun. You know, it's one of the things I love about working at TestPlant, mm-hmm. being really into testing and getting to work on testing tools.
Yeah.
And, you know, talk about what I want in a tool.
And from real life experience, being able to say, here's what I want and here's what I like, as well as getting to talk to other people who do it and say, what do you want and need?
Right.
And I think kind of the theme we're hearing too, which is interesting, I've heard it a lot at this conference, is, you know, the testing or quality organization kind of being the voice of the customer. Mm-hmm. So helping bring in that perspective as they're testing of what does the customer want to see and what is their perspective of what's going on, and making sure that, you know, it aligns and the defects and the things you're finding are around the things that they're most concerned with.
Right.
You know, and finding those areas or zones that you have to focus on based on their, you know, where they're interested.
Right.
And so I don't know if you guys are seeing that too, but
absolutely.
I mean, yeah. I think it's great that you then have that real life touch point direct to the consumer.
Right. So we already have that kind of relationship a little bit where, mm-hmm. You know, we're just big enough as a company that I'm close enough to the account managers that I can kind of get in on the accounts a little and, mm-hmm. you know, what are these guys doing?
Yeah. And get to see and kind of experience it.
And actually, I've asked to tag along on some customer care visits.
That's awesome.
And I'm really excited about that.
Yeah. And I think, too, you know, for anyone out there, I encourage you to do that if you have the opportunity, right? No matter what industry or field that you're working on, I think getting as close to understanding and hearing direct as you can is so important. So having the opportunity to do those visits, or, you know, whether if you do stuff around warehousing, to be able to go into the plants and see how stuff is manufactured, just to give you that firsthand perspective
absolutely.
Of what's happening, I think is always good, you know, for people out there that are, you know, saying, how do you do that or whatever, but just asking, you know, asking, mm-hmm. can I be involved? Can I go out on these things? I think is a good
thing. That's what I've done.
Just raise your hand, right?
Yeah.
And say, I'm in. Just take me with.
Yeah, so, absolutely.
Yeah, a great idea. Any other things that you'd like to share around themes you're hearing or listening to consumers, kind of the next wave of stuff they're asking for or desires kind of out there in the market right now for testers that they're saying, I need this or want this?
Sure. Actually, I've heard a lot this week about models for testing, mm-hmm. about modeling user actions, modeling your programs, mm-hmm. and I think that's fascinating and absolutely necessary as systems become more and more complex.
Yeah.
I'm very excited about that. Also, one of the reasons I like this conference in particular is because automation is near to my heart.
Yeah.
And I hear a lot about automation here, mm-hmm. more so than other conferences.
Yeah. Yeah. There's huge themes around it. So again, for people that are interested in that, I think you get a lot around that topic here when you come here and kind of socialize what people are trying and what's working and, you mm-hmm. know, different strategies. I said, you know, doing these interviews, we heard meta automation and new terms around automation. You know, I always think I know what's cutting edge, but I've heard new things this week right. that I'm like, I need to check into that, you know, on what that is. So we're hearing a lot around that, I think, as well.
So it's really exciting.
Yeah. So a ton of fun. Well, thank you for being here with us. It has gone so quick. Our time is up. But if people want to contact you or, you know, have more questions either about the product or about how to get to speak or, you know, about kind of some of what you're working on, what's the best way to reach you?
Absolutely. I would say Twitter is good. So just Pamela Gillaspie or actually my TestPlant email, pamela.gillaspie@testplant.com.
Awesome. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
And again, I encourage you to reach out and ask questions and ask Pamela anything you guys have kind of have on your mind around some of the stuff she talked about.
Thanks. All right. Pamela. Thank you.